I don't really know if it's cold or not, but it's windy. And it's been really windy for like the last couple of days here, Parker. It's rained. We had some severe weather on Friday. We actually did not, but very close to us. Several of you guys checked in the last video. It was like really close to us, yes, and like in the same county, but a little bit further east. So thankfully we were able to avoid that time change today. So that's great. That means that we can have, nobody's, here they come. Hello! We can have more during the week videos. Unlike Saturday's video, because this week I couldn't. It was just pitch dark. It was pitch dark, Peter Parker. Have you been yelling? Possibly. I think Bunny was in heat yesterday. It's kind of a circus getting the boys in last night. It was. I know, you're chatty. You guys ready for breakfast? It's late, Mom. Because we don't do time change. These guys don't know anything about daylight saving time. They don't. So it's before 9, but to them it's almost 10 o'clock. So they're probably ready for breakfast. Food everywhere. They'll probably clean it up for me, but we'll have to sweep when we get done this morning. It needs to be swept out anyway. Hopefully we will have garage doors soon. That's really the last thing they started painting. And Jeremy's gonna explain all the solar stuff this morning. So if you're here for that, that's coming. But he's gonna explain the whole system. It's up and going. We've got 2 more batteries coming. We have to bury a line, but other than that, it's pretty much good to go. Boys are still just extra intense, extra careful, because what happens is they just like knock you over going in. This works better for me instead of trying to go in and feed them, just because everybody's so hyper right now. They are all happy to be back together, and it does make it a lot easier on me to manage one water. Temperature wise, kind of odd. Like, I feel overdressed, but I'm also afraid I'd be cold if I took my coat off. So as soon as we get our garage doors in, we'll be able to go get our hay. So like last year, we didn't have our friend's hay that they give us. So this year we will have that. We're really, really thankful. It makes feed costs so, so much less in the winter. You know, I go from spending probably $200 a month in the spring to $500 in the winter because I'm feeding double. And so that just takes out some of that cost. Great, but we have to have garage doors so we have somewhere to store it before we get it. She got a little pep in her step this morning. You do. They've been a little rowdy just because of all the rain the last couple of weeks. What really stinks is like we've gotten all this rain and grass isn't growing because it's so late in the season. Yes. Get our Cookie Monsters. Yes. So I'm excited to get free hay this year to kind of offset feed costs. Since I've gone down to 2 videos a week And since we're not, we haven't been consistent a lot this fall, not exactly making as much money and not even making enough like per month right now to cover them for the winter. So thankfully with baby sales and good income from the beginning of the year, kind of offsets winter, but it will be nice to not have to worry so much with that hay that I don't have to pay for. But we're gonna store it in the garage, right in front of the garage door in the back. Our garage space is big enough to park my car and Jeremy's car and store hay in the back, so we made it about 10 feet longer than it needed to be for that reason, so that it could serve as storage for like all kinds of things. Are you guys coming? Yeah! Twiz is always really excited to get out here, but she always gets her first choice at grain in the morning, so she's not in there arguing with everyone. I am excited to have this garage to store hay. The whole reason we didn't take the hay last year was because we didn't have a place to put it. We were having to buy it 2 or 3 bales at a time, have a place in the garage to store it, but then it's also like in the garage and I'm having to park kind of funky and everything was kind of tight. So thankfully, with this new space, we're gonna have a place for me to store my stuff that's not in Jeremy's shop. So Jeremy's gonna have his own shop, his tools, all his stuff that he can work on projects. Let's have a good day. Good girl. Come on, guys. Patty, come on, Padme. Just want some mama snuggles. Hi, Mandy. Okay, so we're gonna try to explain to you guys our solar setup. Now that our house is running basically off the solar all the time, it does have some limits, and Jeremy's gonna explain like what we're not running on it and what we are running on it. If you have more questions, leave them in the description. Our setup is a little bit like unique to us, and pretty much anybody that's gonna install one of these kind of plug and play systems that you do yourself, it's gonna be unique to your house, your appliances, and what you need. There's only 2 of us. We live in a bigger house. So he's gonna do his best to explain it to you, and he doesn't do YouTube, so give him a break.
Yes. That's well, your disclaimer.
That's my disclaimer, so you don't feel like you have to do it perfect. So how big of a system did we install?
I bought 6,500 watts of solar power. We're currently running about 5 of that. You can see over here we have 4 panels that we still have not installed yet because Claire's barn, we used 100% of the roof. I don't know if you've showed them that. We've used all of the capacity. This can go, I believe, up to 7,500. What we ended up doing was I bought my panels from Santana Solar, very popular nowadays. We bought 10 Trina bifacial 410 watt panels, and that's what these are that are here. And then I bought 6 Solar Ever 455 watts. What I ended up doing was, assuming I could get more out of a bifacial, I didn't want to limit the bifacial, so I went up on the monocrystallines to try and get some balance. It is, to kind of give you some perspective, it is 10:15 a.m. after time change, and we're currently generating 3.3 kilowatts on a 4.9 kilowatt system. Obviously, it's going to be different wherever you live. We live in a zone that gets us 4.5 hours of sunlight on average whenever you do your calculation. So this is pretty good. It's a sunny day today, no doubt about it. 3.3 kilowatts on a 5 kilowatt system at 10 a.m. in the morning, I would take that 100 out of 100 times. We have seen it get as high as 4.1, 4.2 at peak on a 4.9 kilowatt system. That's pretty good, you know, 82-83%. Right now we're using 12 panels. There are two six panel sets, 6 series sets in parallel. Gotta get your voltage to match. It's always gonna go the lowest common denominator. So there's 2 6 series panels put in parallel that goes into your PV, into your inverter. We have 4 here, we'll add 2 panels to each series to get it up to where we want to get to. We're currently, the reason we're not using these now, again, I mentioned we ran out of roof space. I'm getting some stuff to ground mount these in front of the barn.
So why did you choose the specific inverter? So this is the inverter, this is the battery bank. And so the inverter basically takes the power from PV into AC so that we can use it.
That's correct.
So you can't use the raw power off the panel that is DC, which is different from AC, which is what powers your house. DC is what comes in from your pole, right?
That's right, that's the heavy line. It allows you to carry a lot of power, a lot of voltage over long periods, and you don't have as much drop. As with everything these days, stuff's tough to come by. If you come to this channel simply to watch what we're talking about here, you probably either know or heard of EG4, and you've also heard about the back orders and all that stuff. We dealt with the same situation. I had originally bought two 6500 EX so that we could do it in split phase, which means panel, both sides of the panel will work. It's oversimplification of it.
So I've been two separate inverters.
That's right. We would have had one.
And they were each. Okay, so we decided to do this inverter is new. It's a new product from the EG4 line, and what we were going to have to do was buy two inverters that were 120 to get a 240. So there are certain things in your house that can only run off 240.
Typically, if you run an electric dryer, that's going to run on a 240.
Electric vehicle charger is going to be a 240-volt plug. Those are those big, funny plugs.
Yeah.
So this is a 120 plug. Like, these are normal 120-volt plugs. But your big dryer plug is your 240. And so most people that are doing this setup with the EG4 are doing two 120 to get a 240.
So originally I had bought two 6500 EX from EG4. That would have allowed us to have a little bit higher amperage, double the amperage actually. We could not get the 6500s at the time. I was itching to get started because we had a lot of other things that were going on. And so I needed to get things wired. I felt like we could, given the size of the solar, that this would operate for us, and it has so far. A couple of things, just right offhand, that I have struggled with this. Number one, it's a brand new product from EG4. I've been on the phone with them a handful of times. There's a couple of issues with it, and I do want to stress to you, we are grid tied. So this whole system, something that's different than most of the community who does most of this stuff, is we are truly going to grid tie. This is a hybrid inverter. Now, I have batteries, so more often than not, we're going to be off grid as it relates to the panel items that we've chosen. We are seeking to have it grid tied as a backup power, and I've had some real issues with that. The second thing I've had issues with this specific inverter is, and I've already been informed that there's some firmware updates. So one of the things that I had when I tried to install this inverter to begin with was the EG4 setting is not working. I've called them multiple times, they can't seem to figure out what it is. The EG4 setting is custom designed settings for this equipment. So this inverter is manufactured under multiple labels. EG4 goes to the same manufacturer as the MPP, as the same manufacturer in a lot of ways as the GrowWatt. Well, EG4 has their own custom settings that they can push out to this unit that allows your batteries and your inverter to communicate, to allow for good communication between the two. And also, a lot of the parameters within deal with voltage of a battery bank. And there could be some variance in all of that. So EG4 designed something called EG4 mode that allows you to adjust settings based on a percent of balance versus voltage. I've been trying since we started all of this to get this to work. Still struggling. I've been told that there's a firmware update coming for it.
As far as the battery bank goes, right now we have 10 kilowatt batteries.
That's correct.
Okay. Batteries. They come in 5 kilowatt. Right.
This is the 6-bank. This is the 6-bank battery that did come with casters. I would highly recommend this if you're getting into this. These things weigh 100 pounds a piece. Wiring on this is so easy. We bought two under the premise we knew we were going to need two more. We have two more on the way.
But 10 kilowatt is not quite enough for us to make it overnight.
It's enough to make us overnight, assuming a sunny day the previous day.
So to have 20 will make it to where we're not running out at 6 a.m.
More than enough. So two limitations to this setup that you really have to consider. How many amps you need to run. Most of your, if you live up in the Northeast United States, a lot of the old houses had 50 amp service and still do today. Most of your later homes were built with 100 amp service. and that was pretty sufficient, but now new homes come in with a 200 amp service. This particular inverter provides split phase, what's called split phase, 50 amp or 25 amps on each leg, which means we get 3,000 watts on each leg, up to 6,000 watts of output. Our coffee pot uses 2,000 watts at 140 volts. That's a 20 amp. So when I'm running my coffee pot, we have 5 amps left on that leg. That's one of your problems. Number two is capacity. 2,000 watts at 5 hours, which you won't run your coffee pot for 5 hours, but 2,000 watts times 5 hours is your entire battery bank.
And there are a couple of high energy items in your house that we had to consider. So like washing machine, dishwasher, the coffee pot, the dryer are all things that require a lot of starting amps as well. Microwave's gonna require a lot of starting amps. Amperage is flow of energy, and so you have to have so much starting amps to like start your dryer, start your washer. And the coffee machine is fine after it's running, but it's starting up the coffee machine. Running the microwave uses a lot of amps.
Yeah.
And so watts is like your amount, where amps is the flow. And so your house has to have a certain amount of flow of energy. So like, is the hole this big or is the hole this big, flow-wise for amps. And then wattage is just usage. And so we toss around both terms, but it's really two different measurements of energy.
That's correct.
That you have to consider how many high amp things in your house are you gonna need to have the right flow. Plus, you've got to have enough storage and enough input to have the watts that you're going to need over time.
When we had originally had the 6500EXs, that would have been, in essence, equivalent to 100-amp service. I believe, given what I've seen out of our house, everything but the exception of my electric heat and air, and we have a heat pump here, was going to struggle to pull, especially during cold times when you need that auxiliary heat. It's just one big space heater.
And something that like he struggled to understand because of how our house runs is that we both work. So Saturday I might be running the washing machine, the dryer, the dishwasher, the heat might need to be running, we're running a TV, we're running a computer, we're running everything on a Saturday all at the same time. And because maybe he's doing something else, he's not thinking about the 10 things that are running in the house. And so that was something that we played with a lot was, oh, I had to plug in the crock pot. And that totally jacks up everything because it uses a lot of amps and a lot of watts because it's heating. Anything with a heating element is what I really learned through this whole process, takes a ton of amps and watts to run. And so for us, we ended up splitting our panels so we don't run our entire house off of solar. So what are the things that we had to pull out that this system wasn't able to do?
One of the things that we did that's mostly unique to people who tend to dive into this, from what I've heard, is we truly wanted to take our whole house, with the exception of a couple of items, and run it off the grid. Most people who buy these things, they're buying the stuff and they're putting in a panel something like this, and they're adding 3 or 4 heavy loads to it, and that's what they're running off grid. Whether it's a car, whether it's a heat pump for their garage, some heavy loads that they want to use over and over, and so they'll install something like this. Well, I wanted to be more of the inverse. This right here was our main panel to our home. There were a couple of things that a high pull, which was a high draw, which is our heat pump for the house and a hot tub that we very rarely use. I pulled those out of the panel, and that's why these windows are there. But everything else we felt like we could run given the battery bank and the amperage. I created a separate panel down here for those items.
We had an old electric dryer, like a 20-year-old electric dryer.
That's correct.
That was not energy efficient at all and was barely working. So for us, it made sense that we changed our dryer out for a gas dryer, but the electric dryer would have struggled. The old energy,
yeah,
terrible electric dryer that we had, yeah, our system would have also really struggled to run that and other things in our house.
We
like would have had to
amps.
Basically run it in isolation for everything else to work.
That's right.
Now, you said that a newer one might have worked better, a more energy efficient electric one, but that's also something on this particular system that has a limit for an electric dryer. So now we have a gas dryer.
Yeah, so it doesn't. We have, inside our home, we have two tankless natural gas hot water heaters. which doesn't pull much amps. So we weren't worried as much about the water heaters. And since the water heater was in the same room, in essence, or a closet next to, we knew there was gas there. So yesterday we ran off-grid all day. We were washing, drying, dishwashing. I mean, we were doing almost any and all things. You're looking at this to see this as two independent systems. These two panels are our house. These two panels have been here. They are what used to be the original setup of the house. For those that aren't familiar, this is an interlock, and you'll see I have another one over there. The interlock allows you to use two different fuel sources, in essence, to power the panel. This panel can be either powered with grid, 125 amp grid service, which is what it is now, or you can flip this off, raise this up, and turn this on, and we have a generator plug on the outside. Now, we talked about gas. We haven't talked about what kind of gas. We have natural gas spigots around the house. We have one on our deck. We're fortunate to have that. I know there's a ton of people that don't have that wherever they live. Technically, this panel can run on either, and this is just your normal generator setup. There's nothing crazy about it. People set these up, just assume this was over there. It doesn't really matter. You can run it on the grid. If the grid goes down, you can get your run-of-the-mill gas, natural gas generator, and it can power the loads in this panel. We also have an inside plug, and I don't know that you can see that. This here, in my workshop, which is where we are now, I wanted a grid-tied plug anytime I needed one, in the event that I needed to pull a heavy load for a short period or a long period of time. I didn't want to have to drain my battery bank in the event I needed it. So that's all that is. Now, because this is our grid panel, this supplies the AC input to our inverter. That allows us to have supplemental grid power in the event that our battery bank goes to zero. It's designed to just switch over. We had to stop the video a second ago. I'm dealing with some feedback. Anyone watching this could help us with this. I'm dealing with some feedback. Whenever I have the AC input connected to it and I have a substantial amount of solar generating, it's like a party in my house. Lights are flickering. And also whenever I pull up the app for my consumption, for grid consumption, it's using the grid. And there's some feedback going on there, and that's another one of the issues I'm having with this inverter. It's designed to just be there as a supplement in the event that it goes to nothing, but whenever we've got a lot of generation going on, it provides a lot of feedback. So we have a solar gland that goes to the outside, and this is called a DC shutoff. All that allows me to do is I can flip that, and then any of the power that's generated from the solar panels can be flipped in the on position. Be sure, whatever you see here, check, double check, recheck, hire professionals. We even hired some to do a couple of things in our world, so I highly encourage it. There is an interlock here. This was something I really wanted on my home panel because maybe it's lack of confidence, but more about it, just wasn't sure if my wife would stay married to me after I got all this finished. So I decided to keep this interlock in place, which means the way it's working now is this breaker controls the PV power or the solar power. In the event that we're tired of it, it's malfunctioned or whatever it is, I simply can turn this off, this drops down, and I can turn it back on, and now we're on grid power as though nothing ever happened.
And this setup it's designed to be a DIY plug and play setup. So it's not overly complex, but it just means it has some limits. So it's different than, it has all the basic same things that if somebody has come knocking on your door trying to sell you solar, like they are here, like at a mad crazy rate. It has all the same components, but this is really designed for you to be able to do this yourself. The things that we used an electrician for were to set up the completely new panel with the new main power and do all that. If you do a grid tie system, which is what most people are selling right now, where you back feed to the grid, which we do not do, it has to be installed by an electrician, like the entire thing. It needs to be, and the power company has to approve it. So like you have to have whoever you receive your power from involved in that setup.
And that may be different. You know, we're in Arkansas. We talk to people, you know, Montana, there may be, I'm making up a state, I don't know. Montana may be lax on their restrictions and regulations, whereas New York may be different.
Eventually the barn will be tied into this as well. So it'll be all one system. And so instead of having my separate system in the barn, where we ran into issues with like it's freezing outside, so we have to unplug the batteries and bring them in.
or we have to rent a space heater to keep batteries warm.
Just kidding.
So this is gonna allow me to run everything I need to in my barn, but to invest the money, it was kind of one of those things, why not go ahead and invest the money to do some of our house and that, because really what I needed, so many kilowatts to be able to do those things, those batteries, that you might as well invest in this. And it's one of those things that's where we started with it. We built it up a little bit more than what we needed, but we were able to tie it into our house.
So this has been a 2-year journey for us. When we first moved here, it was overpriced and it was insufficient, but you have to start somewhere. You know, Renergy sells on Amazon. I'm sure if you've seen them, you can look online. It was 100 watt panels. We bought 200 watts of panels, 200 watts of battery, 2400 watts of battery with 200 watts of solar. But that was where we started. And it was probably $500 or $600. And we ran that for a year and a half and realized, okay, these are the benefits. These are the things that we struggle with. It taught her how it functions, the hardships that you have, whenever it's raining or snowing or whatever it is, we figured it out. And so it was through that we got enough confidence to be able to do something like this. We use a roofing rack. We have it on a roof rack system. I installed it myself. I am not as svelte as many people. It was great. It was a Tamarack system. I want to say it was $500 or $600, worth every penny. It was so easy to install.
But the pitch of the roof on the barn is not very extreme, so we were able to do it ourselves, versus the pitch of the roof of the main house would not have been safe without some heavy equipment. So they were basically able to climb up on a ladder, he and his older brother, and do that with the help of like his dad and our nieces and myself helping to hand things up.
Yeah.
Where if we had done it on the big roof, I don't know if they would have been as comfortable doing without like a cherry picker or some other piece of equipment where they weren't standing on the roof, or not hiring somebody that was experienced. And also that's a metal roof. It is not an asphalt shingle roof like our house. And so
installation was a little different.
And if the barn leaks a little bit, it's not the end of the world, versus if our house leaks a little bit, that is the end of the world. So also those things to consider, that we had the benefit of being able to install that on a barn roof and not our own roof, and that may limit you in your DIY journey. So if any questions, just leave me a comment. I'll have him answer them.
Oh, she'll answer them.
I won't, because I won't know the answer. If you guys are interested in any more specific information that we didn't provide today, you know, our videos are shorter videos, so I'm not going to do a 45-minute video on this, which we could probably do an hour-long video.
And there's tons of people that show how to install these things. If you've got a specific question about how we install one thing, feel free to ask. It would be a waste. There's so many good, I couldn't do it justice. There's so many good installation videos.
You know, for us, offset, as far as cost goes, I think payback period is about 2 years for us with this.
Yeah, so, and that's really coming down to the fact that we did it ourselves.
And that's also due to the high energy cost too. Like, our energy company has sent us letters twice in the last 6 months that they're increasing our rates for energy. So that's really those kind of things. So your system is going to be unique, but definitely shoot us some questions and I'll have him answer them. Mm-hmm. But as far as like just the basics of what we did.